Shall I begin then?
No, I'll just start it. Since you have to share the screen and all, I think I'll just start and introduce. So that, okay, we have good evening, one and all. Welcome to CCB's 41st online meetup. We have met in January and February, we had a break, but again in March, again, we're back and very happy to see all the faces gleaming out there. And today we have two reviews coming up. One is from Sandhya and one is from me. So the second one will be there. I will be doing the second review. So before I start, Sandhya would like to share the screen. She's going with the PPT presentation today. The Theory of Everything, right? So that is the book Sandhya is going to review, by Stephen Hawking. Sandhya, I would request you to share your PPT and start your review, because it's going to take some time.
Can you all see your screen?
Yes, we can see your. You can do a full screen perhaps. Yes, better. And others, I request them to mute themselves.
So, good evening all. Today I'm going to review the book, The Theory of Everything, which was written by Stephen Hawking. So, Stephen Hawking is a scientist and a physiologist. He wrote many books. As you can see, he also wrote A Brief History of Time, which is mostly connected with the time, the four films and all. So, this book actually talks about how the universe is formed, how everything is happening up there, which we don't know. Most of the time we look up at the sky and wonder what is happening up there. Especially myself, I sometimes look up at the sky and wonder what is up there that is so interesting, what is up there that in the vast space we do not understand. So this book is actually very, what should I say, easy to understand, because compared to all the other science fictions and all, this is less with mathematical equations and all, and they also use very less scientific terms, which is easy for someone who is not from the physics background can easily understand it. So this book contains 7 lectures, which was written by Stephen Hawking. As I can say, this book is a contains scientific knowledge, because every lecture contains one of the scientists who already discovered something and or who are trying to rediscover something else. So this book contains 7 lectures, which is mostly about the universe, cosmology and all. So the first lecture is ideas about the universe, and then the expanding universe, the black holes, aims of black, the origin and the fate of universe, the direction of time, and the theory of everything. So I'm not going to review about all the 7 lectures now, because it is too much to handle for my brain to understand also. So I'm going to explain about some of the synopses that are spoken about in the book. Before going into the book review, I have read about the author and also the physiologist Stephen Hawking. He was diagnosed with ALS at the age of 21. And was given a life expectancy of minimal 3 years, but he managed to increase it by another lifetime, which he lived for 74 years, and also he completed his life achievements. He discovered so many things. He wrote some books. He also wrote so many articles about his favorite theory, which is black holes. I should thank, because of him, we get to know so many details about the black holes. The lectures which include, we all know, we have been reading from since childhood that Earth was flat, that we are all living in a flat Earth. But we are all living on a flat Earth, but due to his so many people discoveries and all, it was mentioned in this book that Aristotle was the first one who discovered that Earth was not round, flat, and indeed round. When I said Aristotle discovered it, Aristotle was the first person to discover it theoretically, to prove it theoretically that Earth was round and not flat. There are so many people who discovered that Earth was indeed round physically, but they are not mentioned in the book because this book contains scientific and proven knowledge. Aristotle's universe states that Earth lies at the center of the Earth, while all the other planetary objects like Moon, Mercury, Sun, Mars and all, they are also static planetary objects which lie around the Earth. But later, this Aristotle's theory was rediscovered by other persons, so many people, and Ptolemy rediscovered it and stated that and all the planets were not static, but they move in a very closed area, but in a very less time, less speed they move. So they stated that Earth is at the center of the universe, and all the planetary objects revolve around the Earth, but in a very lesser speed. But as the planetary objects expand through the universe, we have another realm which contains fixed stars. They also stated that the past stars does not move and they are static, and also the stars as the realm of the stars expands over, we don't know what lies after the fixed stars. So later on, this theory was rediscovered by Copernicus, which stated that it is not Earth but Sun lies at the center of the universe, and also all the other planetary objects stay around the sun, which is the correct explanation that we are following right now, because this is the normal model of the universe. Sun is at the center, all the planetary objects around it, and also because of his model, he also stated that Moon is not a planet, but it is a object that revolves around the Earth, and that is the reason the Moon appears twice as big as its size once a month and also disappears once a month. So he stated that all the objects that are present on the universe, it revolves around the sun. Later on, so many
Sandhya, we are not able to hear you. Sandhya, we are not able to hear you. I understand Sandhya's got disconnected. Let's just wait for her to connect back. Yeah, she's back. Sandhya, you're audible.
Am I audible?
Yeah. You can continue your presentation.
Yeah. So that is when Newton's law came into the force, which stated that everything in the universe attracts everything else in the universe. The more massive the objects, the stronger the force of attraction is. He stated that because of the gravity that is present around the sun and all the other planetary objects, they could not collapse into each other. It also stated that because of the gravitational force, they could stay away from each other and could not fall off or could not collapse into one another. Later on, as they were starting to study about the gravitational force, and also because of this book, I have understood that the apple which was fallen on the Newton, it was mostly fabricated. Because the idea of gravitational force was previously there, the apple just helped it. So as they were studying about the gravitational force and all, they have started to doubt about what lies after the fixed stars, which is the vast ending of universe contains numerous of stars, numerous of galaxies. They discovered that our universe is not the only universe, and our solar system is not the only solar system that is present in the universe. So which led to the doubt of if there are so many universes in the galaxy, what what was the beginning and what was the ending of the previous universe, and what was the beginning of the present galaxy that we are living in, which led to the doubt of how our Earth and how the solar system was formed. So many churches, many other scientists believe that there has been a numerous of floods, disasters that occurred during the past times, which set back the human race to the first point where they have started. So it was very divine to believe that something like disaster or something else like eruptions or something that caused the decline of human race. So they started to recalculate all the stars, all the stars illumination and all, which is also there is an Indian scientist who participated in this discovery. His name is Mr. Chandrasekhar. There has been a statement in his name also, which is noted as Chandrasekhar limit. It is used to demonstrate how illuminosity and how light effects can be calculated for a star. So if the star is anywhere near our galaxy, we can see it more clearer. When the star is far away from our galaxy, it might not look that closer to us. So with the help of this Chandrasekhar limit, they have discovered 9 other universes that are present in the galaxy, which led to the doubt of how our universe began in the first place. So later on, so many people, with the help of calculations, with the help of theoretical knowledge and all, they have believed that there has been a singularity in the universe, which is called the Big Bang. The Big Bang means that before Big Bang, they were believed that the solar system is a compact point. There is no enough atmospheric pressure and all for us to live on it. So the Big Bang caused the time to move fast, and the climatic changes happened that happened after the Big Bang, which led humans to inhabit the Earth. So it is also stated that the time that is present before the Big Bang would not affect the time that is we are living right now. So whatever that happened before the Big Bang would not be accountable for anything that is happening right now. So if anything major event that happened before the Big Bang would generally does not affect us. So it is not taken into the consideration. So what happens after the Big Bang is what we have to recalculate and we have to discover. So with the help of Big Bang and all the theoretical gravitational force that is given by Newton, it is believed that the universe is not just a limited area, but it is an everlasting vast space which has no end. So if you take I have an example. This is Hubble's law. Hubble's law means, according to the Hubble's law, there are 2 theories in which we can predict the space between the universes. It is either all the galaxies are flying apart from the each other. It must be, if the universe is expanding, all the galaxies would also fly apart from each other. And in the same way, if the universe starts expanding, the space between the universe would also expand. Maybe that is the reason why we couldn't contact the other universes until now. And also, if this theory is anywhere correct, if at a point A we observe the universe from the point A, then the point B universe would also observe the same thing, because the space between the universes might be different. But there is no starting point or ending point in the universe which can be described as the center of the universe, because every other universe would believe that we are the center of the universe, and that is why we can see the vast end of vast space, and there is no end to the universe. And also all the observers who are present in the other universes would observe the same thing. They would have same set of stars, they have same set of galaxies, they have same set of space between them. And also the universe would also look same from the each side. If we want to observe this more practically, if we take a balloon as an example, and puts dots on the balloon, the more we blow air into the balloon, the more the dots would flow apart from each other. If we take one dot as A, and if we take the other dot as B, and if we observe the balloon from the dot A, it would look the same from the dot B also, because the space between the balloons would and would not be the same, but we can never predict which dot is the center of the balloon and which dot is the far away from the universe. So it is believed that the universe is a vast space which has no beginning and also no ending. So the theory proves that if the universe is expanding at a smaller rate, the gravitational force would act on it and helps it to expand more. But the repulsive forces that is acting on the universes, at some point they would start to contract around itself. So if you take a rubber band, if you expand it, at some point the expansion rate will increase and the repulsive forces will act on it and makes the rubber band contract around itself. The same would happen, that is the point they took for the Big Bang also, which is that if before the Big Bang there might have been a situation where the universe has expanded to its limits, where it has to contract around itself again. So that contraction comes in a force which the gravitational force cannot stop it. So because of that gravitational force density and all, the universe would start contracting, and later on it would contract around itself and then again starts to expand. So it is a continuous process. It's not just the humans, but it is just for the universes, the life and death is a continuous cycle. So that is how they believe that universe is infinite and there is no begin and there is no end to it. And also the Fredman theory proved that if the universe expansion starts at zero and increases to the maximum, and then again it declines to the zero and the contraction starts, and then again the expansion starts, it reaches to the maximum, and then the contraction starts, and then it reaches to the zero. In this book I have found that these two quotes are very, very important, not for the cosmology and universes. It is generally important for how humans see universe, how we can relate to everything that is happening up there, which is black holes, aims of black as they painted. They are not eternal prisons they were once thought. Things can be get out of a black hole, both on the outside and possibly to the other universe. So if you feel that you are in a black hole, don't give up. There is a way out. So it is very much believed that the black, what lies after the black hole is yet unknown. But as per Stephen Hawking's researches and all, Stephen Hawking believed that there is a other way out of black hole. So in the same way, if we are stuck somewhere in the life, if you are stuck doing something, it won't be the end of it. Like, we still have a way out of it. If you just work on what the possibilities and what we might come out of it. So if you really doesn't want to stuck in a place, there is a way out of everything. And also, no one created the universe and no one directs our fate. This led me to the profound realization that there is probably no heaven and no afterlife either. We have this life, one life, to appreciate the grand design of the universe, and for that I am extremely grateful. The one thing that is to be taken into consideration, that even though Stephen Hawking was diagnosed with ALS at the age of 21 and given the life expectancy of only 3 years, he worked on himself so hard that he was able to beat his death, and also he was able to achieve so many things even in the condition that he was in. So if you take him as an example, nothing in the life seems harder than that, because no matter what situation you are in, no matter how bad position you are in, there is still more you could do. if you try harder, if you take really think you need to do something, you just don't have to give up on it. The more you try to do something, the more you can achieve it. So I think this book doesn't just speak about the universe's fate, expansion and all. I think this book tells us about how if we try harder, there are still so much to learn, so much to achieve. So I think this book has taught me that it is never too late to learn something. It is never too late to do something. Even if you might not understand what is happening at this point, there is still so much of time to learn it, so much of the time to apply it to the present situation you are in. So I think that helps a lot, because whenever you feel like you're stuck, there's still so much to learn and so much to look up for. So I would end my review with this. So I think I would recommend this book to everyone, because this is not just for the physics students. This is for everyone who questions what is happening and why the universe is so vast and what is there up there. So I think this is a nice book to read. Thank you.
Thank you, Sandhya. That was a very crisp yet serious presentation about a book which talks about science. Of course, we don't have need specific introduction to the kind of works that this wonderful person has done. I would request all of you to please unmute yourselves and switch on your videos for the interaction.
Yes,
please. Is someone speaking? Yeah. Any comments, any thoughts on this? Please go ahead. We are the room is open for interaction and questions. Already. So, one question from my side, Sandhya. You were talking about the black holes, right?
Yeah.
So what exactly is given in terms of like that's theory from his version of what is it in a short form? Like what does he talk about?
Yeah, actually the black hole is something where black hole is a star. He believed that black hole is a star which has a higher density, but because of all the external forces that is acting upon it, light could not escape it. Because of light could not escape it, light could not reach it also. Because of all these things, one could not see a black hole, but they can feel a black hole. Then whenever, when there is a black hole around the space, the satellites might, can transmit the energy to the other things and all, but one could not see a black hole with a naked eye.
And just one more question on my mind about why he named this book so, like a theory of everything, he said, right?
So yeah, actually, I was curious to know why the name, the theory of everything is. I believe that it is because all the work that he has done, all the work that he has learned because of his discoveries and all, he believed that this could be the theory of everything that is happening around the universe, everything that he has discovered. So I think it is his theory of everything.
Okay. Thank you. Yeah, Sairam, go ahead.
Am I audible?
Yes.
Yeah. First of all, it's a nice review. Thank you, Sandhya, for this excellent book. Like, I haven't read this book yet. I should have read it. I'm planning to read it from long time. Actually, I first read about this book in some newspaper article or something. I just don't remember. But back, years back, I remember, I read some book with the name of Philosophy of Everything. There's a young author called Saranya Kannan. She's from Chennai. She sent her book to me. Review, I think so. I just read her book. It's such a nice, she wrote it in a very nice way. Right in the preamble, like the index of that book, she just mentioned Stephen Hawking's name, with this book, and then I just thought of reading this book. I just remembered this book again. So right from then, I was thinking to read this book. So my question is that in the ending of the review, you just said like the philosophy what you have spoken. Is that the same way it was written in the book, or was it written in some other way?
Can you ask it again?
I couldn't get you, please.
Yeah, the same thing else. Can you please ask it again?
Yeah, it's like the philosophy you have said in the ending of the book, the life doesn't stay the same. We have to know the answers for every single question, right? So, yes, was that written the same way, or any other things? Would you like to please explain that?
No, it wasn't. It wasn't written in the same way. It was what I have learned from the book. It is what I thought the book tells us. Because of his life and because of his discoveries, though he is disabled, though he had many reasons that he could give up, but he still didn't. So I think that is something to learn from him.
Such a nice points you have got from that book. Surely has shown all your school teacher skills, trying to explain it in a particular way, like even haters of physics like me could understand. Thank you.
Harsha, any more questions? Any others questions, please?
Hello, good evening.
Yeah, please, Poonam ji, yes.
Sandhya, the last slide that you have shown, and it's written over there, no one created the universe and no one directs our fate. This is what he has written in the book.
Yeah.
These are his words. So we can actually get this point from whatever is written. What I can understand is he suggesting atheism? Like no faith in God, no one created universe, no one directs our fate. Like, is he suggesting something like that?
No. I think he is not suggesting atheism. He is not trying to prove that there is no God. He is trying to prove that if there is God, we have to find out. We have to question why, whether it is there or not, we have to find out.
Clever answer.
All right. Does that come to, yes, Harsha, yeah, go ahead.
Ma'am, such heavy duty stuff, it's very difficult to,
agree.
Digest.
Incidentally, today, both the books are kind of a little heavy on the data. So it just happened incidentally. So I think it's for the people who are here.
Her courage to take up this book and present it, that itself is a very big thing, ma'am, for me. So theory of everything, it's great. I mean, I'll read it sometime. I like physics. I have a physics background, so I'll read this book definitely. And I just browsed it. It's just a 140 page book. And so is it right, ma'am, Sandhya?
Yes.
So I think I'll try to read this. It's interesting, but everyone was saying, the theory of everything, is it everything? What is it, everything? Is it really everything? I don't know. I just read a book recently, ma'am. If you permit me, I just share a brief ideas of the author. It's written by Ray Kurzweil. He's a technological head in Google, I guess. He wrote a book called The Singularity is Near. Mm. Actually, he is a futurist. He tries to predict the future, and his prediction rate is some 80% or so. He doesn't predict just like that. He has a technological understanding of where things are moving and where are we heading to. So he bases prediction based on technology, based on the semiconductors like transistors, Moore's law, all this stuff. Okay. So interestingly, he put across a point while I was reading the book. He told that if you look at the evolution from information point of view, information theory point of view, information from the perspective of information theory, I find it very interesting. He told there are six epochs or six paradigms in the way the evolution has happened from the point of view of information. If you consider the Big Bang, what he was also referring to, Big Bang, let's consider it as the start of the universe. Now, information initially during the Big Bang, it is stored
Sorry to remind, Harsha, can you finish this in 2 more minutes?
Yeah, 2 minutes. Like it won't take more than that.
Go ahead. Yeah.
So it takes information used to get stored in the form of physics and chemistry, like in the form of atoms. Okay. Now the first paradigm that happened after that is information is getting biology. Information is stored in the form of biology, like DNA. You know what happened in between? That's a black box. No one knows. The universal constants are so precise that life happened, the self-replicating beings started, this self-replicating information started from DNA. And after that, after DNA, the third paradigm, after biology, the third paradigm is this DNA is self-replicating and it created organisms where we can sense, the surroundings from our senses, we sense our surroundings and then started. And then the fourth paradigm is the technology. In the third paradigm, information is getting stored in the brains, human brains or animal brains. Brain is the information storing information processing thing. And the fourth paradigm, the information is getting stored in the external technological innovations like computers, silicon chips. That's where information is storing. That's where the information, you're processing information. And the fifth paradigm is where the human strengths and technology, like and the computer strengths, we merge together, humans and technology. And the last paradigm is the paradigm is very interesting. He says the universe wakes up. Like we have limitations, humans have limitations, but technology doesn't have a limitation. When they merge humans and technology, there is no limit. So I just remembered all these things. I just want to share. That's it. But anyway, the review is great. Thank you, Sandhya.
Lovely, Harsha. Thank you so much for contributing with some more information. Wish you could take it up as an exclusive one for someday. Let's hope so. If I am not wrong, we are done with the questions. Please, Doctor.
Sandhya, a science student or an art student?
Not a student, sir.
Beg your pardon?
Yeah, what's it?
You're a science student or an art student?
No, I'm non-science student.
She's not a science student.
That means she has done a good job.
Okay.
Really, she did very well.
Yeah.
She did a good job.
See? Not taking science has come to your advantage today. Okay. So with that, we end the first book review.